Every scuba diver knows this feeling. You roll off the boat, water starts rushing in, and within a few seconds, you realize that the exposure suit you're wearing is either your best friend or your biggest mistake. Hello everybody and welcome back to another episode of Scuba Science. In today's episode, we're going to talk about exposure suits, specifically about wetsuits and dry suits. This program is fully self-funded, but if you are a fan of DiveSAGA or of Scuba Science in particular, then make sure to like the video. That helps a lot and it's very easy for you to do. You can also subscribe to the DiveSAGA channel and you can become a member. If you become a member, then you get access to the DiveSAGA scripts and to some of the soundtrack. You can also pick up some DiveSAGA merch in the store below. To understand why we even wear exposure suits to begin with, we need to talk about heat loss. Water conducts heat away from our body 20 times faster than air. So whenever we are immersed in liquid, scuba diving, it is important to help prevent this heat loss. Even in tropical water, a short amount of time underwater can result in some serious cooling down of the body. There are four main ways in which our body loses heat: conduction, convection, radiation, and evaporation. When it comes to scuba diving specifically, the two most common ways that we do lose heat is conduction and convection. Conduction, or heat by touch, is literally when we lose heat because our body is in contact with water and warmth simply transfers from our body to the water around us. Pretty straightforward. You can compare this to, for instance, putting a metal spoon in a cup of tea. If the tea is hot enough, then eventually so will be the metal spoon. Convection is the movement of heat by a flowing fluid. In other words, cold water moves itself around, and so transporting heat away. And that's actually the principle that wetsuits use to keep you hot, because it traps water and stops it from moving away from your body. The goal of any exposure suit is simple: trap heat, reduce water movement, and insulate you. Let's start with the classic exposure suit, the wetsuit. A wetsuit does not keep you warm by keeping you dry. It is called a wetsuit, after all. What a wetsuit does is essentially trapping a thin layer of water around your body. And your body will, of course, heat up this water through conduction, but since it is trapped and can't move, it's not as easily going to transport that heat away from your body. You will still feel that initial rush of water entering the wetsuit, but typically, if you've chosen the right wetsuit for the environment, you should not cool down too much more after that. Wetsuits are made of neoprene, and neoprene is a form of synthetic rubber. A synthetic rubber that is full of tiny gas bubbles. What provides the insulation is not really the layer of water around your body, it is those gas bubbles in the neoprene. This is also why the thicker those bubbles are, the better the insulation. Remember that gas is a poorer heat conductor than liquid, so the thicker the bubbles in the neoprene, in other words, the thicker the wetsuit, the better the insulation. But there's a thing. As you know, as scuba divers, and you know Boyle's law, in other words, the pressure increases as the depth increases, this also means that the pressure on the wetsuit increases. In other words, the pressure on those bubbles in the neoprene increases, which will make them reduce in size. In other words, wetsuits get less effective the deeper you go because the layer of insulation gets thinner. This is something to think about if you're getting into doing deeper dives. You may want to level up to something stronger. If your wetsuit fits poorly, then water can move around freely. We call this flushing. And when water is being flushed in and out of the suit, your body will of course have to heat up every new bit of water that it comes into contact with. This is essentially going to lead to heat loss. So it is very important to wear a wetsuit that is very well fitted. That's almost as important as choosing the correct thickness. Between wetsuits and dry suits sits a somewhat in-between category called semi-dry suits. Despite the name though, semi-dry suits still get you wet. Semi-dry suits do have tight wrist and neck seals, and therefore reducing even further the amount of water flow in and out of the suit, which will allow you to keep that layer of water that's trapped on your body nice and warm. Semi-dries are kind of a good deal for climates that maybe get colder some parts of the year, but do not really warrant the purchase of a dry suit. For instance, the Mediterranean in winter. And now for the big guns, the dry suit. The dry suit, as the name implies, is designed to keep you dry. But it is important to realize that dry suits aren't designed to keep you warm. They are designed to keep you dry. So they still need to be combined with a set of undergarments, a layer of clothes worn under the dry suit that actually provides the warmth. As we mentioned earlier, air is an excellent insulator. So being able to add puffs of air into a dry suit and thus creating a shell of gas around your body helps with keeping you warm. And because you, the diver, controls how much air goes into the dry suit, you not only control to an extent this amount of insulation, but you also control your buoyancy. This is one of the reasons why dry suit diving does require specific training, as it does change the way you dive. Generally speaking, there are two main categories of types of dry suits: neoprene dry suits and membrane dry suits. Neoprene dry suits look and feel a little bit more like wetsuits, and they have some built-in insulation. They tend to be thicker and a little bit more rigid, and they're a nice segue for people who are used to diving in thick wetsuits to venture into dry suits. The trade-off is that they are heavier and a lot more buoyant. Membrane dry suits, on the other hand, really just act as a shell to keep you dry. The benefit is that the suit itself will dry easier and quicker, but the trade-off is that you need to really pick your layer of undergarments. Most of the time, tech divers, for instance, will venture into membrane dry suits because they have much more control exactly over the layers of undergarments they choose to wear. I, for instance, literally have a collection of different undergarments ranging from just a base layer when I choose to use the dry suit in relatively hot water to an extremely thick undergarment, even with built-in heating. I actually talk about that in one of our episodes. Because yes, even integrated heating inside the undergarment is possible, which of course is going to keep you warm even more so. But dry suits are a little bit more complicated and therefore not only require specific training, but also a little bit more care. Dry suits, of course, need to be equalized as we're diving. In other words, air needs to be added. And so dry suits have an inflator connection. This inflator valve, just like any other inflator valve on, let's say, a BCD, does need to be kept clean and regularly maintained. You can imagine that a stuck inflator valve on a dry suit is a pretty big problem, as big as it would be on a BCD, for instance. Because we inflate our dry suits upon descent, we also need to deflate them upon ascent, and that is why dry suits have at least one overpressure valve. This exhaust valve is typically located on the left shoulder. Some variations do exist. But there as well, it is important to ensure that this exhaust valve, which is essentially a one-way valve, works. It is not uncommon for poorly maintained dry suit exhaust valves to start leaking and water to actually start entering through the exhaust valve. So proper maintenance there is key. On top of that, much like when you first learn to dive with a BCD and probably inflate and deflate a lot to control your buoyancy, it is not uncommon when you first start learning how to dive with a dry suit that you have to inflate and deflate a little bit more than is ideal. But of course, practice makes perfect. A dry suit also has a big zipper, and this zipper is quite important because, of course, it cannot leak. These are very heavy-duty, waterproof zippers that are specifically made for this purpose, but nevertheless, it is very important to take good care of your dry suit zipper. They must be waxed regularly, and of course, for every dive, it is super important to do a double check that your zipper is indeed fully and properly closed. Otherwise, your dry suit is going to be a very expensive wetsuit. And lastly, dry suits also have seals around the neck and wrists. And these seals are of course a little bit more fragile, so they also need to be inspected properly and sometimes replaced. So you can see that a dry suit is a more convoluted piece of equipment than is a wetsuit. This is also reflected, of course, in the purchase price. Now, which one is right for you? That's of course a very personal question, and some people do get cold a little easier than others. What I'm going to say now are general guidelines, but by all means, listen to your body and get guidance from a local instructor. This YouTube video is in no way a replacement for any type of training. Generally speaking, if water is above 24 degrees Celsius, consistently so, you're probably absolutely fine in a wetsuit. Even below 24 degrees Celsius, you may be fine, but it could be a personal choice. In these temperatures, even a shorty may be just fine, if you want to wear a shorty. From 24 to 15 degrees Celsius, I would probably opt for a full-length wetsuit or maybe even a semi-dry. And if you're closer to 15 than to 24 degrees Celsius, you want to think about the thickness and probably upgrade your 3mm to a 5mm or even a 7mm suit and maybe add a hood. Once again, it is a personal choice and you do need to trial and error this a little bit, or maybe have a look what other divers in your area are comfortable with and use that as a starting point. If you're going to dive below 15 degrees Celsius and you're going to do multiple dives a day or much longer dives such as technical or cave, it's really time to go dry. As we mentioned earlier, dry suits do also offer the benefit that you can adjust the layering of whatever you wear inside, which gives you a lot more control over your exposure protection. It can also function as a backup buoyancy device to some extent, so there are multiple reasons to go dry. So where wetsuits are fairly simple in design and relatively cheap when you buy them, dry suits are another story. And since dry suits are not exactly flexible, you also need to make sure that you buy the correct size and then not gain too much weight. And indeed, the additional training and the additional maintenance on a dry suit is also an additional investment. So where wearing a wetsuit is a fairly easy practice to adopt, dry suits does require specific training. And I would highly recommend that you actually take a specific dry suit diving specialty course. A lot can be said about the validity of certain specialty courses and how useful they really are, but I do think if you were ever going to take one, dry suit would probably be it. Of course, if you're learning to dive from the get-go in a dry suit and your instructor is experienced and gives you all that knowledge, great. But if you are, for instance, a wetsuit diver and are considering going dry, please take the training, typically not long and hugely beneficial. Again, as I mentioned earlier, you will have to learn the additional element of buoyancy control through the dry suit. And you will also need to just remember to inflate the suit as you descend to offset the squeeze. So it is a new set of automatisms that you will have to start learning. On top of that, a good instructor should also be able to point you in the direction of how to properly maintain your dry suit. It is not cheap, as I mentioned earlier, so knowing how to properly maintain it will put some longevity on a relatively expensive purchase. That being said, in my opinion, once you master dry suit diving, it's kind of hard to go back to wetsuit diving. Yes, it is very flexible and feels super free. Dry suit diving is a little bit more work, but I think most dry suit divers will probably argue that they just feel at home in their dry suit. It just adds a level of protection and, in my opinion, a feeling of safety that you just can't match with a wetsuit. Now I'm curious, are you a wetsuit diver or a dry suit diver? And if you are a dry suit diver, do you agree that once you are a dry suit diver, it is kind of hard to go back to wetsuit? Let me know in the comments below. I'm very curious to know what you think about that. Thank you so much for watching the Dive Saga channel. I appreciate each and every one of you. And if you can, please like the video. That helps so much in relation to the algorithm. And if you want to become a Dive Saga member, you can also do that below. See you next time.